what is in-context learning.
Slightly related to the previous question, and thinking about the kinds of things that that language models can do, or especially that we were surprised to see that language models can do. Maybe one of the most surprising was this phenomenon called in-context learning, where if I take a little machine learning data set and I just feed it to the language model, right? So I give it a movie review and then the star rating that was assigned to the movie by the critic, and then another movie review and the star rating that was assigned to that movie by the critic. And you know, give just a couple of examples of these things. Language models generate the ability both to sort of, you know, generate plausible sounding movie reviews, but also to predict the star ratings that should come after them, right? And more generally, if I have a machine learning problem, I have my inputs and my outputs. I put some inputs and outputs as input to the model. I give it one more input and I ask it to predict the output. Models can often do this really well. And this is a like super interesting, sort of fundamentally different way of doing machine learning, right? Where I have this one big general purpose model into which I can insert lots of little machine learning data sets and get, you know, without having to train a new model at all, classifier or a generator or whatever, specialized to my particular task. This is actually something we've been thinking a lot about in my group and in some collaborations with colleagues at Google, trying to understand exactly how this in-context learning phenomenon actually comes about. What are your thoughts on the potential of LLMs? Should people be scared, excited, or somewhere in between? I think the answer is somewhere in between. Certainly in the short term, the thing that I'm most scared about has to do with these sort of truthfulness and coherence issues that I was mentioning before, right? That even the best models that we have today do generate incorrect facts, they generate code with bugs, and sort of because of the way these models work, they do so in a way that's like particularly difficult for humans to spot because the model output has all the right surface statistics. And so when we think about code, right, I think it's still an open question whether it's actually less work for somebody to write a function by hand or to ask language model to generate that function and then have the person go through and verify that the implementation of that function was actually correct. And, you know, I think there's a little danger in sort of rushing to deploy these tools right away that will wind up in a world where everything's a little bit worse, where it's actually very difficult for people to actually sort of reliably check the outputs of these models. That being said, I think these are problems that can be overcome. I think, you know, the sort of pace that things are moving at, especially, there's a lot of room to address these issues of factuality and coherence and correctness of generated code and things like that. And that in the long term, these really are tools, I think, for freeing ourselves up as a society from a lot of sort of unpleasant or drudge work that has been difficult to automate, and that that's something to be excited about. How to deal with ethics issues if generative AIs generate data and the fake data is misused in some way. We deal with these ethics issues in the same way that we've always done, right? With sort of legal processes and societal processes and governmental processes that are designed to address them. At the end of the day, people are using these systems, right? They're not fully autonomous. There are people who are sort of responsible for their inputs, responsible for their outputs, responsible for their behaviors. And I think, you know, thinking that the sort of issues associated with the ethical deployment of these technologies is something that we as technologists can solve is really misguided, and that in fact, you know, there are already sort of sophisticated structures in place in our societies and cultures for dealing with factual issues, for dealing with generation of untruths or unreliable or incorrect outputs or bad machine decisions, and that we really need to think about strengthening these systems rather than trying to come up with technological solutions or purely technological solutions. Why do LLMs tend to hallucinate facts, that is, confidently assert things that are not true? And does that limit the usefulness of these models for applications where factual accuracy is important? We've alluded to this hallucination issue a couple of times. And I think why it happens is still partly an open question. But if I had to guess, right, just sort of architecturally, there are reasons that these big transformer models, that it's hard for these models to build coherent models of the world, right? And they can do that a little bit. You can sort of query them for with like factual questions, trivia questions, and they get them right most of the time, maybe even more often than your sort of average human user off the street. But unlike your average human user, it's really unclear whether there's anything that lives inside this language model that corresponds to a sort of belief about the state of the world. And I think this is both for architectural reasons, right, that just transformers don't obviously have anywhere to put that belief, and training data, right? That these models are trained sort of on the internet, which was authored by a bunch of different people at different moments who believe different things about the state of the world, and therefore it's sort of difficult to expect models to represent those things coherently. All that being said, right, I don't think this is a sort of fundamental limitation of sort of neural language models or even more general language models in general, but something that's true about today's language models. We're already seeing, right, that models are sort of approaching being able to build representations of facts, representations of the state of the world, and I think there's room to improve further. Is it ethical for these systems to use the first person when interacting with users? Should they respond with, as an AI language model, I, or something like this generative text prediction system? This is a great question. So I certainly believe that it's very, very, very important for deployed versions of these systems to make it clear to users that they're interacting with, you know, some sort of automated decision-making process and not, you know, an actual human user on the other end. And that kind of transparency is, like, really fundamental for getting people to trust these systems and understand their limitations. I don't think it's necessarily a problem for these models to, you know, use the word I, that they don't have to refer to themselves as this generative text prediction system every time. You know, I think we're already used to dealing with personal assistants like Siri or Alexa or Cortana that refer to themselves in the first person. But I think there are ways of doing that while still making it extremely clear to the user and maybe reminding them periodically that what they're interacting with is not a person. Is it possible for LLMs to contain mini neural networks within and adaptively use these mini neural networks for in-context learning? This is a great question, and you know, sort of related to the in-context learning question that we had before. And so, you know, I'll give specifically a shout out to my student Ekin Akurek's work in collaboration with folks at Google, aiming to answer exactly this question and showing that at least in principle, it is possible for transformer language models to sort of train mini machine learning models inside of them and simulate that training process and use the embedded models to make predictions. Whether this is actually what's going on in sort of the larger scale models that we have right now is an empirical question. Whether that, you know, sort of little mini model that's getting simulated during in-context learning is a transformer or something smaller or something simpler, something different, all still unknown, but this is an active area of research and one that I'm particularly excited about. Is it possible that an LLM is fine-tuned with other kinds of data, for example, time series data, and perform well? Yeah, so this is also a great question. And you know, I think right now, when people think about applying language models to other kinds, you know, data in other data in other modalities, other problem domains, they are thinking about sort of converting those problem domains into text, querying the language model in text space, and then getting the answers back out. But this is not the only thing that you can do, and it's definitely possible to take a model that's been pre-trained on language data and fine-tune it on data and other modalities. And what's especially interesting there is that if you succeed at doing this, right, then that tells you that the language model has learned something not just about language, but about kind of structured data sets in general. So here at MIT, one version of this that we've done, my group in collaboration with Antonio Turalba's group, and actually also some folks at NVIDIA, is look specifically at what happens when you take language models and fine-tune them on robot demonstrations. And there you do actually really seem to get improvements in models' ability to sort of generalize to new tasks and new goals. And I think that's some evidence that pre-training on language data tells you something not just about language, but about, you know, kind of structure in general. LLMs are getting a lot of attention right now, but what other new AI or ML models are also seeing meaningful progress and should we keep in mind in the coming years? You know, in terms of sort of basic, like, neural network architectures that we have for solving prediction problems, these, you know, sort of like one token at a time, what are called autoregressive models, are the rage in NLP right now. But people who work with other kinds of data modalities still use different kinds of models, right? Obviously, in sort of image generation land, there's a huge amount of interest in diffusion models that underlie a lot of the image generation results that people are seeing right now. There's still a lot of use of convolutional neural networks. And recently, there's been quite a bit of interest in looking at you know, sort of ways of applying tools that people use right now, mostly for working with image data, and using them to work with text data instead. And I guess looking a bit past the, you know, kind of like low-level neural modeling questions that, that a lot of people are thinking about right now. It wouldn't actually surprise me if we see a return to some of the more like explicit structured approaches that, that were at least more predominant in a previous generation of NLP approaches, right? So there's this like whole long tradition of formal representations of meanings of sentences basically as chunks of code, right? That you can sort of answer a user's query by not just sort of pulling the answer to that query out of a language model, but translating it into, you know, a database query or something even more abstract, a little computer program that you can run and execute to get answers out. And one of the things that's really appealing about language models or language to code models in particular is that they actually make it a lot easier to implement a lot of these kind of classical structured approaches, right? So if you sort of take very seriously linguistic theories about how sentences ought to get represented, now you can implement those theories computationally, not by sort of spending an entire PhD handcrafting some kind of model, but just by showing a language model a couple of examples of the kind of representation that you're interested in. So, you know, thinking back to what we said before about language models maybe not being great at building models of the world or solving sort of really complicated computation or inference problems, there I think there's actually a lot of room to use language models just as a building block in more complicated systems or more sophisticated systems that map from language to code or other kinds of structured representations of meaning as a stepping stone towards final answers. If GPT-5 was a student of yours, how well would it do in your classes? So, well, GPT-5 isn't out yet, so I don't think any of us knows quite what it's going to be able to do, but there's a really deep question there, right? Which is that the many of the classes that I teach, or at least the main NLP class, is all about doing original research. And, you know, the sort of question of to what extent these models are able to produce original ideas of their own, to what extent they're just remixing things that they saw in the training data, is still, you know, like I guess many of the other things that we've talked about today, a big open scientific question. So I suspect right now, you know, GPT-4, maybe even GPT-5 is not going to be great at like coming up with and implementing end-to-end new NLP projects, but who knows? Okay, I think that's all we have time for, so thanks very much for listening, and see you later.